What's the difference between the two?
I don't even look at, compare them.
One's stamped the 18th and one's the 12th?
Yeah, but I don't see anything different on it.
One's revised.
Yeah, but I don't see, I don't understand what's...
It's number five C, I believe.
Yeah, they added five C.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's on both, it's on the...
No.
No.
Oh, wait, you, never mind. Never mind.
Both copies?
Yes. Yeah, I have a bad copy underneath.
I made a copy.
Good evening, I'd like to welcome everybody to the regular meeting for the North Branford Planning Zoning for Thursday, May 19th. In attendance are regular members, Holgren, Sienna, and Dulac. There is a, if anybody hasn't got one, there's a revised agenda that was previously sent out. So the first order of business we're going to have is the minutes and approval from the May 5th meeting. All three of us were here, so if you haven't had a chance to look at the minutes, please do so.
I move that we accept the minutes of May 5th.
Second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Seeing none, that passes three to zero. Okay, old business. And PZ application 2014-15-6, Carrie, is there any updates on that, or?
No, the public hearing was closed at the last meeting, so at this point...
No, that's, I'm sorry, that's the propane, I'm sorry, no.
So for propane, yes, I spoke with Bob Gilmore today, and they, DEEP did receive a petition of approximately 40 signatures requesting a public hearing. So what that, what happens now is that it goes to adjudication, and adjudication means that they are potentially setting up a meeting with the applicant and the lead petitioner to try and reach some kind of resolution, if that's possible. They possibly hold a public hearing at some point. Bob Gilmore wasn't sure if that would be in Hartford or if it would be here, and he'll just keep me updated.
Okay.
There's no timeline on that, right?
Right, so no timeline, and we can't act until we have a report from DEEP.
The DEEP approved it, found no discrepancies with it, right?
With their draft report, yes.
And then they reopened?
They, no, then they, after they completed a draft report, they have a 30-day comment period that started on April 21st. So that ends May 21st.
If they had 30...
If they had 25 signatures requesting a public hearing, then that pushes it to adjudication, which is where we are now.
So the adjudication is a pre-public hearing meeting to resolve the differences?
Right.
But if they have a public hearing, if they don't adjudicate and it goes to a public hearing, there's no standings in a public hearing if they already approved it, right?
It's only a draft.
Well, and I don't know, one thing that Bob Gilmore said was that everything has to relate to wetlands, and I don't know how much discretion DEEP has as far as deciding to hold a public hearing or not.
Okay. They have to come up with something that's, to push the public hearing, it has to have, they have to have a reason that would override the wetlands or something, right?
It can only, it has to pertain to the wetlands and the impact that the proposal would have on the wetlands.
But we don't know when that's going to happen, the adjudication meeting?
No.
Or where it's going to happen?
Right, and I, the adjudication meeting would not be open to the public.
Okay, so the next order of business is old business, it's PZ application 2016-5. It's for the
revision and text amendment to the, for accessory dwelling units. I know we left off a couple, because we were going to do change of terminology and stuff like that.
Right, so this is where we had closed the public hearing at the last meeting. And one of the notes that I had was a question regarding what counts as a separate egress, because there was questions about from the building code perspective. So I talked to the building official, and going through a garage is not considered an egress. So you would have to have, if you have bedrooms in, say, a finished basement with a kitchen, you would have to have a door to the outside. It couldn't solely have a door to a garage as the only means of egress.
Do you need a door, or could be an egress window out of the bedroom?
Door, it's got to be a door.
For the building code, it sounded like it needed to be a door, but...
Oh, because the two-story houses have to have a window of a certain size.
No, this is, remember, this is if we're talking about a separate dwelling with a kitchen, a bedroom.
Right. The thing coming to mind is I know of a one-bedroom apartment that has a door. It's an apartment, so of course it has a door. But it also has to have an egress window in the bedroom.
We don't require that. It was just, it's always meant to have a, if
so
you have an accessory,
so
no, you have to have a separate door.
I'm talking about an apartment, and if an apartment doesn't have a door, will a egress window suffice? Because that's fire code.
Form of egress.
A form.
Now as it pertains to this regulation, if you want an accessory dwelling,
right,
you have to have a door.
There is one door.
Not a window. It needs to have a door.
Well, it said a second egress. It requires a second egress, which could be a window of fire code rating.
Oh.
So,
that's not the intention. The intention is if you're going to add or have a separate accessory dwelling, that you require a door. If we need to put the door in the word of egress, but we use egress, it needs to have a separate door to be considered an accessory dwelling. If it's a window, it's not going to
no,
go
no,
as an accessory dwelling.
One door, not two doors.
To the accessory dwelling.
Right, one entrance, one access.
Right,
in the garage,
it has to be to the outside.
Correct. Okay.
Right, to the garage.
Right.
That's, in the garage, it's not count. Right. So it needs a door that goes to either front or back.
It says separate egress through an outside door.
Right, so not a window, but it has to be an accessory dwelling. They have to have their separate in and out.
Okay.
And the intent for having that in here was so that if there was a second kitchen with a living space and sleeping quarters, but it was part of the home and didn't have a door to the outside, that would not be considered an accessory dwelling unit. So that if you had grandma living in this basement or a separate area of the home, and there was no separate door leading to the outside, that would not be considered an accessory dwelling.
It could be an in-law apartment, though, right?
Yeah.
It just, you wouldn't have to go through this permitting process of needing a zoning permit.
Okay.
And building code is separate. But
it wouldn't have to be separated because it's an in-law apartment, then?
Right. Right.
Now, the lady that was on from Doral Farms, why did she have to come in front of us?
Because there were two separate units when you entered in, and there was the outside door to the lower unit.
Okay, that's right. All right. Yep.
That's, in my mind, what it could have been rented, and you could have easily put in a door separating the upstairs unit from the lower unit. So, I didn't change anything else, I don't believe. Do we want to go through it just to make sure that everyone understands the proposed text change? So,
why don't you put that in into the, send us a final one, and then we can act on it next meeting.
It's in here.
I think it's in there.
Oh.
It should be in there.
attached to the...
Nope, never got one.
Look at it.
Did you?
There you go.
Oh, I did get one.
Hey, why don't you, you want to just roll through it really quickly?
Sure, sure. Okay, so this is proposed changes to the accessory dwelling unit. First is under the definitions section. We added that it's a self-contained dwelling unit, accessory and subordinate to the primary dwelling, excluding condominium units, apartment units, guest houses, group homes, boarding house, and mixed uses, which is attached to or located within a single-family dwelling having a separate egress through an outside door, containing a floor area, which is where we increased it to 1/3 of the gross floor area of the principal unit, or 250 square feet, whichever is less, equipped with its own meal preparation area and sanitary and sleeping facilities. Either the single-family dwelling or the accessory dwelling unit shall be permanently occupied by the owners of the premises. Only one accessory dwelling unit shall be allowed per single-family dwelling.
I guess, not to beat this to death,
mm-hmm.
but if it's a separate, self-contained, one-bedroom apartment with a outside door, do our existing building codes require an egress window out of the bedroom?
I don't know.
That would be the building official.
Right. I mean, would that affect this at all?
No.
No.
Because what I'm picturing is a single-family home. They add on, just to make it easier, they add on, maybe convert a garage
mm-hmm.
to a one-bedroom apartment that's attached to the home, so it would be on the ground floor.
Assuming. But even if it were a walkout, but I thought the code was all bedrooms needed egress, unless they're grandfathered in.
Well,
you know, of a specific size that the fireman can break through the window with his Scott Patrick in.
So how does it relate to an accessory dwelling, I guess? Is,
the building code
should,
of the windows is a separate.
Should we change this to?
Well, that would be in the building code
yeah.
when they
well,
apply.
Because we're specifying a separate egress through an outside door. Well, if I put an outside door, therefore I do not have to put an egress window.
No. Again, my thinking behind it, and it came from our discussion of adding that, was it would be easier to rent it if there was a separate entrance.
Yes, I understand that, but
so I don't think
can they read this as being that the egress is through an outside door, not through an egress window in the bedroom.
We're not overriding any building codes. So.
Right.
No, I just.
Right.
Building code says every bedroom has to have a window of a certain size. It still has to have a window of a certain size.
Right, and the building code has more teeth than zoning regulations.
Okay.
Yeah, because
you're
going to show us, no matter what they do, they're going to show us a floor plan that needs to be approved. So if there's no window in it and the building code requires one, they're going to have to put one in.
I want to go through and do the... certificate of occupancy, you can say,
yeah.
This is the
yeah, exactly.
Pass.
Yeah. So I think we're covered in that.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, so then moving on to change section 23, schedule A, line A-11 under R-80 and R-40 from special use to PA, meaning a permitted use in the district as a matter of right, subject to additional standards specified in section 44. So this was one of the largest changes. It would be taking it from requiring a special use permit, which means a public hearing and notifying abutters within 500 feet, to making it as of right, so long as they meet certain standards.
So it basically just goes to the building official, say they're going to make accessory dwelling and...
And the zoning officer.
Yeah, yeah.
Right.
So.
Send a site plan and get a permit, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
This cuts out one step.
Yeah. All the years that we've had accessory accessory dwellings comment, I don't know how long I've been here for, but I think there was only one that kind of came into question, and even that went through.
Setbacks.
Yeah, that's basically, but I've never seen one denied for sure, and only, like I said, one really questioned, you know, so I think that works.
Okay, so then this would be under, again, the as of right. So here would be the following standards. The accessory dwelling units, the purpose of this section is to promote the general welfare of the town by allowing an alternative dwelling. An accessory dwelling unit is a dwelling unit that is accessory and subordinate to a single family detached dwelling. Such accessory dwelling unit constitutes an additional use for which a zoning permit and certificate of zoning compliance are required. So again, that's that large change from mm-hmm. special use. And then the standards, A is, which is already in there, the principal single family dwelling or the accessory dwelling unit shall be permanently occupied by the owners of the premises. Prior to the issuance of a zoning permit, the owner shall submit an affidavit to the zoning enforcement officer certifying that either the accessory dwelling unit or the principal dwelling unit is occupied by the owner of the premises as required for the original application. This is also where we had removed the section that talked about you have to wait 3 years prior to constructing it. So someone could construct a new home with an accessory dwelling unit in it, or an in-law apartment. B is a zoning permit certificate of zoning compliance shall automatically terminate when there is a change of ownership of the premises, unless the change of ownership is for no consideration. New permits and an affidavit will need to be submitted upon a change of ownership of the premises. And then C is the use shall be located on conforming lots in R80 or R40, meeting the minimum area, location, and bulk standards of section 24. The dwelling unit shall be attached by a common wall, floor, or ceiling, not simply attached by a breezeway or porch, and shall be contained in one building. The building's appearance shall conform with the single family character of the neighborhood, preserving natural topographic features and the historic values of the area. E, the units may have separate outside entrances, but the accessory dwelling unit shall have only one outside door along the front facade. Any additional exterior egress serving the accessory unit shall be located to the rear or side of the building. So that gets into a little bit more of the detail of the egress.
Additional egress.
F is the floor area, which is increased to not to exceed 1/3 of the gross floor area of the principal unit, or 750 square feet, whichever is less. If not served by municipal sanitary sewers, East Shore District Health must provide certification prior to approval that the on-site septic disposal system is capable of accommodating the accessory dwelling unit. And G is the requirement to have 2 off-street parking spaces on the lot for each dwelling unit. And H, both dwelling units shall share the use of 1 street address assigned by the town of North Branford. The only thing I realize that is not in here is one thing that you mentioned, Harry, about submitting a floor plan.
That would be the zoning, though, right? They go for the permit?
Well, I wonder if we should just add it in here.
I think we should, just to make sure that somebody reads the regulations. So, says, oh, look at this, we just got to do this, and then also they get there and there's no site plan.
So if we have an accessory dwelling unit, this is, if we have it under 44.8, where it talks about additional use for which a zoning permit and certificate of zoning compliance are required.
Mm-hmm.
But if we say additional use for which a zoning permit, including floor plan.
Well, wouldn't they get that, need that to get a permit?
Yeah.
So maybe it's redundant. Yeah, that's true. Yeah, that's fine.
Because either they're going to do it when they build a house new, they got to submit a plan, and when they go to get the permit to add it, mm-hmm. they need a floor plan.
Right.
To show you where it is and on the, as proposed, really is all it is. And then,
right.
then they, when they get the final approval, then they do the walkthrough and make sure it's mm-hmm. conforming.
Yeah, okay. So I drafted a motion outlining everything that we just talked about.
Oh, I just, I gotta go back to one. I know we, I'm gonna quote Ron, he's just like a dead horse, but the, can we just go over E again?
Yes.
Okay. I think we had an extensive discussion last time on E.
Yes.
If I'm not mistaken. Don't want to do that again.
Okay.
I just want to make sure that I'm clear that, so the accessory dwelling, there could be, they can have a front door to, in front of the property, and there would be, obviously the house, the main part of the house would have a door, so that's all you can have there is those two.
Yes.
You don't have to have two, you can have the main house, front door.
Yes.
And the accessory dwelling back door.
Yes.
Okay. Because just the way it says, an additional exterior egress serving the accessory dwelling. So it can have two, right?
Right.
It can have two, but it can only have one in the front. Okay, I'm good.
So, right, so when it says the units, they're talking about the single family dwelling and the accessory dwelling.
Right.
May have separate outside entrances.
Yeah, I just wanted to make sure.
You could have 10 doors, but only one could be in the front.
Yeah, and then we don't have to worry about any windows.
The whole back of the house could be doors.
Yeah,
house of doors.
Well, and not to beat a dead horse, but the single family dwelling under E, the single family dwelling could have two entrances, but the accessory unit could only have one.
On the front facade.
On the front facade.
Right.
Yep.
So I have a draft motion which would have an effective date of June 6th, and then at the bottom there's just, because it's a roll call vote,
yep.
And then also reasons for approval, if that's what you'd like to do. Probably just say as reviewed in the draft motion, what do you think? Or do you want him to read the whole thing?
No, I'm not going to read the pages.
Right.
Yeah. I move to approve effective date June 6, 2016, changes to planning and zoning application 2016-5 as previously discussed.
That's pretty much it.
That's it.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion that we already have? So it's just a roll call vote. You can start off, and there's some comments in the other pages.
I can make up my own. I vote yes only because I think it streamlines and it's more realistic to have 750 square feet for an accessory dwelling in law apartment or whatever. That's more of a realistic size, and it takes the burden out of the zoning board of appeals.
I approve the motion based upon simplifying the code to add accessory dwellings to houses.
And I also approve, for some of the same reasons Ron and Dave have presented, also it meets with our conservation development plan. Also, I think it's, more importantly, I think it streamlines it, also makes it a little bit quicker when some individuals have, parents that want to move in, it doesn't have to go through the notification process, which can take at least a couple months, probably to go through the whole process. And also, I think it does put it back in the hands of the zoning enforcement officer and the building officer to make any tweaks to those floor plans that come through. So I go yes, and that passes 3-0.
Yes, please.
Okay, we have new business, modifications to PZ application 2015-4, that's 1831 Middletown Ave. So I think that's why you're here?
Yes.
Yeah, you can come up and... Just your name and your name and address.
Hi, Peter Dale, with New Haven Sign Company.
Jim Guimond, 1831 Middletown Avenue.
I'm just gonna pass these down.
So if you could just, if you wanna just go through what the revisions are?
The main revision is the sign, the road sign. We'd like to increase the square footage to 132 square feet, where the 50 square feet is currently allowed. The current zoning regulations allow for us to take some of the square footage from the wall signage and apply it to the pylon sign. The reason why we would like to do that is add a tenant directory, so all the tenants will have some exposure on the street. Emergency personnel will be able to see where people are, should they like that. Also, it streamlines the building signage by reducing the square footage on the for each tenant.
But the original plan on the sign, you said you're reducing?
Of the building.
No, we're gonna reduce this. The regulation says that if we reduce the square footage that's allowed on the wall signs for the building,
yep,
we can apply that square footage that we take away from the walls to the actual pylon sign. And that's what we'd like to do, just to do the modification on the site plan to allow for that.
So that's in your packet. I included the language just so you can read through it.
How big is that sign that's in the picture now?
130, well, actually it's 6 by, the sign itself is 48 square feet.
So the two black areas below the sign?
That's just it's just a pole cover.
That's where you wanna put the...
And that's where we'd like to put the tenant directory.
So this is the existing sign size you want?
That's the existing sign. That is the existing sign. All we're gonna do is add tenant names to the bottom, but the regulation says that if we put a name on it, it increases the square footage, so the name actually becomes a sign. So we're not increasing the footprint of the sign at all, we're just gonna add tenant names to it. In all actuality, we've already taken an existing non-conforming sign, which was huge. It was 7 foot by 10 foot, was 70 square feet, and we reduced it. We reduced it in height and in square footage. So now we just like to add tenant names.
Currently, how many tenants do you have in the buildings?
30.
That's 29.
Yep, so there's gonna be, that sign's gonna be plenty to put them on there?
Yeah, it'll be plenty.
There could be two per line, maybe, or?
Yeah, well, we still haven't laid it out because there are certain tenants. One tenant has 3 units, he only needs one sign. There's another tenant that has 3 units, he only needs one sign, and so on, it goes on like that. So we're not gonna actually put 28 or 30 panels on it.
Right.
What's the square footage of each individual tenant sign?
On the pylon sign?
Yep.
Well, if we split it in half, it's gonna be roughly 12 inches by 4 feet, so 4 square feet per tenant. That's if we split it up that way. But we still have to determine how many individual tenants are there.
Some owners have 3 units, so they would only require 4 units would go towards one name for one company.
And it depends on, we're gonna go over the leases, and it depends on how long, if they have a long-term lease, yes. But we still have to build in room for expansion. The guy who occupies 4 tenants decides to move out.
So you might have a unit number and a company name.
No unit number.
Okay.
No unit number, because that would get a little confusing. Just, we're gonna list their names.
Because the 3 units might be different areas of the park.
No, well, he may have unit A1, A2, A3, yeah. A4.
Right.
So we're not gonna put A's 1, 2, 3, and 4 in Caltech performance. We'll just list Caltech.
There's a sign on the outside, so we should be able to find it.
Right, absolutely. There's no current signage on the building, and that's something that Carrie and I are working on later. We're going to put a tenant directory on building A and a tenant directory on building B. That will have, say, suite A1 with his name. So now they know where to go.
So we met briefly before, so I'm just gonna raise the question again. So why not just have the Northford Industrial Park sign take up one of these spaces, and then have an interior directory. So at least people will get in to the lot, and then whether it's on a separate directory or on the wall, see where each tenant is. Because I still think that driving on Middletown Ave, I don't know that people would be able to read it because it's small.
Well, that, go ahead.
No, go ahead.
Well, that's one of the options.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
One of the options is doing that, but we still need to increase the square footage of the sign, because if we do that, we still want to identify Northford Commercial Industrial Park right there. And then we'd also like to, if we can't do the directory, if you don't like the directory, then we'd still like to do a little bit more advertising for the storage,
for the
where
self-storage.
It says, for the self-storage, where it says book online with, you know, with a
right.
website. So again, we're not increasing the footprint of the sign, we're just adding, we'd just like to add some text to it to get a little bit more exposure, either for the tenants or for
self-storage,
self-storage and the industrial park.
So, if, like down in the Northford Center, the plaza,
yes.
they have the one main sign, and then they have all the listings on there?
Yes.
Correct.
So, I mean, the only thing is, I drive by, because you can't see down there mm-hmm. from the road. I mean, you know there's something back there.
Right.
You know, I mean, so, and, you know, to promote business, I mean, putting the name of the businesses on there. I mean, I agree that when you're driving past there, you're not going to be able to, nobody's going to read all 15 of them,
mm-hmm.
but if you know you're going 1831 Middletown Ave to Company A, you know, as you pull in the drive,
you're going
to you know, if it's an alpha order, which I hope it would be, or something like that, that you might be able to see it, you know, as you're
yep.
going in. I mean, as far as having a directory on it, there is one down the center of
yeah, we're getting pressure from the tenants also, because they want their name out there.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah. And they have businesses, and we understand that.
And on the old sign, they had their tenant names listed. So,
you know, this is Northford Industrial Park, but no, it isn't. It's Northford Self Storage.
Right.
You know, you got a big sign here. You got a billboard.
Right.
And to be honest with you, I've got a couple of phone calls about the size of the sign. And, you know, the red, and it's, it is legal though, right?
The size, yep, right,
yep.
And we can't
so
regulate
it's not
content.
Being received the way
right.
you intended to be received by
right.
people in the area. So that being said, I guess it's, is it legal for them to reduce the sign on the buildings and keep this?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
It's so
then why are you here?
Oh, no, it needs your permission. So I'm just going to read.
It's a site plan revision.
I'm just going to read.
Change to what we have on the site plan.
I'm going to read the wording.
It's a change to what was there before.
If we change.
It's a site plan revision. Basically.
If we change the site plan, then we're actually changing the zoning regs for the signage on the wall sign. We're actually telling them they can no longer have, because right now it says we're allowed 10% per, you know, for the whole building. We're actually going to reduce that by taking that square footage. That's going to be written into the plan.
So Ron, here's what it says for, so ground signs. In business and industrial districts, which this is industrial, the commission, in connection with the approval of a site development plan, for any lot on which a large enterprise, a shopping center complex, or an industrial park is to be located, may authorize the applicant to reduce by a specific amount the maximum area of signs permitted to be attached to buildings, or to eliminate such signs, and to provide one sign attached to the ground that is larger in area than otherwise permitted in the district. So they are right now at their max, which is why they're here, because they need your approval to take, as Peter said, take the square footage from the building and put it on the pylon sign.
Okay, but then if you do that pylon sign and reduce the signage on each building, is that per unit to only 10%?
It's, so the way that the regulation is written, it's you get, each building gets, for a wall sign, they get 10% of the square footage, which is the length of the building, up to 12 feet. So the largest building is 200 feet long times 12 feet high is 2,400. 10% of that is 240 square feet. That's just for their first side. Now, the way that the regulations read, it says for any additional signage on any additional wall, it drops down to 5% or 40 square feet, whichever is less. And on all three sides, it's more than 40 square feet, so that drops down to 40 square feet per building side.
How would the two directory signs impact that?
Well, it's, what is it that you're asking for or that you need? You wanted to go up to 83?
Yeah, we're taking 82 square feet away from the wall signs. So that will reduce each wall sign.
But then you want to add two directories.
Then that would be taken away from the wall sign, the tenants as well. Once we'll go for a permit, we'll go to zoning, we'll get a permit for the directories.
And then I don't think the business sign, right?
The directories, interior directories, if I read the regulation correctly, a directory is not actually considered a sign. You can put directory signs in a complex, and it's not, you don't have to get a permit for a directory sign. It's considered directional. Directional signs don't require permits. So that it's mm-hmm. identification signs.
Yeah.
Identification signs require permits.
We would have to talk with our zoning officer, but directional sign I think of as stop or arrows or.
Yeah, I'm also thinking, you know, the fire department coming in there, you know, now that that sign's getting smaller, you know, do we need a stamp from Bert, the fire marshal, about what they need?
Mm-hmm.
That's, you talk about the interior sign, so I mean, when that comes through, we can always have, I mean, we wouldn't see that, that would just go.
Well, the key is, I think you need the interior signs. Yeah.
The interior directory
signs.
I'm
with you on that.
Right.
The interior directories we're going to put one on each building. It'll say mm-hmm. building A, and then it'll have the list of the tenant. There's suite numbers for each tenant. And then each door is currently labeled right now.
Right.
Suite A, you know, A1 through 14 and B1 through 14.
Carrie, did you visit the site with Tom?
I have been up there, yes.
Did Tom go up there too?
Tom went up there.
Comments from the CEO will be provided.
Yep.
Does he have any comments?
They're white.
So Tom and I sat down.
It's going to be a white panel with black lettering on it.
Tom and I sat down and Tom thought that what made sense is to look at the square footage of the largest building, and you know, he was saying he feels like 240 square feet is plenty, and if they wanted to transfer some to the main sign, that would be reasonable, but not all.
And that's what we got.
Yeah. Oh, it'd be ridiculous
and,
to transfer 200 feet.
The other thing just to mention is the way that our regulations are written is it talks about allowing wall signs on buildings, and so, you know, doing that calculation. Technically, there are two new buildings on the property. They're storage units. It's my interpretation that the intent of these regulations is not to include the calculations from the storage units to allow signage on those buildings, because I think that's over signage for that parcel. But the way that our regulations are written, it could be interpreted that you would have signage on those buildings as well.
Yeah, if it was a standalone storage unit and the complex wasn't there,
right,
it would be allowed a sign that says Northford Storage. You'd be allowed a ground sign and a wall sign. So I'm thinking that would be how, that's why the regulation is written that way, I'm thinking.
Right.
But I don't think you plan on putting anything up there.
No.
That main sign is right next to the storage unit, so no more signs are gonna go up on the on the storage units.
No.
At that point, you're oversigned.
Is this not reflective of the new sign? This is what we originally approved, correct?
No, this is new.
That's a new one.
It shows a sign over here.
8 by 10.5. Okay, 8 square feet. Right.
When the storage units came in, a sign was not included as part of the site plan application. They pulled a separate sign permit and were allowed to do what they did, which was the 50 square feet.
Okay.
It's just the addition, you know, adding to it, which is why it's a revision to the site plan. But one other, is this internally lit?
Yes.
Okay.
The existing sign was internally lit.
And then would the, so all the tenants would be lit at night?
No, tenants are non-illuminated.
Okay.
Nothing changes to that bottom part of that sign, other than adding tenant names. There are going to be individual panels that can be removed if the tenant moves out.
Are you going to do it on both sides?
Both sides. Yeah.
So does that double the signage square footage? It's two-sided?
No.
Anything else on this?
No, not on the sign part.
Okay.
But I do want to just have them stick around and talk about the landscaping.
Okay.
New Haven Sign going to do all the signs on the buildings?
I'm not sure. I was a tenant there, no longer. So if I was still a tenant, I had a good shot at it.
I guess my question is, will the signs be uniform in that?
Yes.
What was the question? I'm sorry.
You mean the wall signs for each tenant? Yes, we discussed that he wasn't going to allow tenants to put them on the actual building. They're going to allow them door signs, certain size, certain shape, and everyone would be consistent on the door.
Right. And on the outdoor sign, it's all going to be the same lettering,
text,
paneling.
Correct. White background, black lettering, same font, no logos.
That was my next question.
Right.
Yeah, they look like mishmash if you put all this.
And what else do you have besides this?
Well, I don't know. Let's maybe, if you want to take action on this, and then the other component just of this site,
okay,
while we're talking about this property, is talking about the landscaping. But I think we should maybe close up the signage.
Oh, yeah.
Because we would need a
motion. Oh, that would be separate. Yeah, this is separate than any other discussion we're going to have?
Yes.
Okay, all right. I got you. I thought we might be included in here. Is it supposed to be in here?
Yes.
And what's this in here?
So.
That should be read into there?
Yes.
All right, I got you.
Should we,
This is you.
But before we vote on it, should we, we've talked about the style of the additional sign, but does it state in here what they're going to be? Should it be stated what it's going to be?
The directional signs? Like?
No, the signs here. He's saying he's going to use a white background with black letters. It's all going to be conforming, but does it say that here?
Oh, let me see the draft back. We can maybe just put it in there.
We'll submit that to Carrie for the sign permit.
Yeah, so
we'll submit a new drawing to go to get the new permit.
You can just do another bullet because the first is a condition as well.
I have visions of the Ferrari
tenant
stallion, in cursive, and then right under a target with a
bullseye.
Shall be.
What size are the units over there?
Pardon me?
What size are the units?
There are 1,000 square feet on
tenant.
Because I remember last year, we had a person come in wanted to open a. They were looking for 1,200 square feet for
tenant panels,
a brewery,
tenant panels.
Start up a home brewery, weren't they? They asked if we were interested in having them in this.
Yeah, he did approach us. We said no to that. Did he come here with that?
He asked if the town was open to having a brewery in town. I said, all right. But he couldn't find a unit the right size or something.
Right.
Yeah, I don't know, 1,200 square foot he's looking for, 1,500 square feet.
There's a lot of waste involved in that. Fire. Brewery, that's what we were concerned about.
There's a lot of, you brew them wrong and blow your sides out.
Right, right. Exactly.
Well, it depends if you're on a, if you have septic or sewer, right? So, yeah, where's all that stuff go, right?
Right, exactly. That was our concern.
It's like putting a laundromat on the property.
Right, exactly. Yeah.
You know what?
Have you been down to that new brewery in Stratford?
Two roads.
No, have you been on one?
Two roads?
Yeah.
See the one in Brantford?
Yes, it's Stony Creek.
What a gold mine, 3, 4.
Yeah, I did that sign.
Oh, you did? That's nice. That's, did you did that sign?
Both.
Oh, that's nice. I always admired, I didn't know you did that.
Oh, wait, okay, back.
Turn it back.
To be approved.
No. They did, did you see the one strapped?
No, I haven't seen it.
They got this big sign that looks like a beer cap. It's all made out of aluminum. Whoever made it.
Nice job.
Yeah.
Yes.
Building official?
Read the whole thing?
Please.
Okay, make a motion to approve PZ application 2015-4. Revision of the application of the site development plan under section 23. Schedule A, line C 13.2, for construction of a 2 indoor self-storage facilities, phase 1, associated storm water management and landscaping at 1831 Middletown Avenue, assessors maps 77 lot 22, zone I3, owner applicant Alberta Management Inc. to increase the square footage of the ground sign as shown in the improvement location and survey noted below. Improvement location, survey building A and B, land NF 1831 Middletown Avenue, LLC 1831 Middletown Avenue, North Branford, Connecticut, prepared by James Sazano, LS dated April 8th, 2016, revised May 2nd, 2016, added pylon sign information, scale 1 equals 40 feet, 40 inches, I guess. Add plans, conditions approved July 9th, 2015, shall remain in effect, and the following additional conditions shall be adhered to. Per section 52.5.6, ground sign, the North Branford Planning and Zoning Commission is allowing the increase of the square footage of the ground sign by adding additional tenant information at the bottom of the sign. Total square footage of the sign is not to exceed 132 square feet. Tenant panels on pylons shall be conforming in order in color, font, and style to be reviewed and approved by town planner.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Seeing none, that passes 3-0. Takes care of that part. You had something else you wanted to add, Karen?
Should we do a motion to amend the agenda to add discussion about landscaping at 1831?
Yeah.
Just because it's a different topic.
Brian, can you make Dave make a motion to amend the agenda to include a discussion on the
landscaping
of 1831 Middletown Avenue?
I'd like to make a motion that we amend the agenda to include landscaping on 1831 Middletown Avenue.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
So this is the same parcel. Here's the approved landscaping plan. And then in talking with Ben this evening, this Kurt took this today. These are landscaping that's going in, but instead of the white pines, they're actually Bartlett pears.
Yeah, Bradford pears.
Bradford pears.
So where are the white pines supposed to be? Are we talking about right across the top?
These asterisks.
Oh, okay.
There's 8 white pines.
Okay, where? Okay.
So this.
Where's the entrance? Where's the entrance? Okay, that's the entrance right there.
Yes.
Okay.
So what we did is we put 5 Bradford pears in and 3 birch trees. Equivalent in size to the pines. Plus we had another 30 plantings.
So the question is, they were supposed to be white pines?
Right.
Pears and dogwoods? Pears and dogwoods?
No, birch.
Pears and white birch.
And then no-mow grass and wildflower.
So let me ask a question. Where?
So this, if I can just turn.
Oh, okay,
so this is the building.
Down here.
Over here, yep.
Mm-hmm.
And the pears are haven't been up there, but I think they're, you know, are they generally spread out along the front?
They're 30 feet apart across the front.
So the question for the commission is, are you okay with substituting the pears for the pines? And then also, if you look at...
What's the difference in elevation from the road?
This area is where the...
To where the storage is.
So it may cut into some of the parking.
Isn't it, is there a drop there?
Quite a bit.
Probably like 10 feet.
At least.
Somewhere around there, right?
Yeah, 8 to 10 feet.
The proposed is 70. Sorry, they're required to 70, proposed to 85. So they have some too.
So these are native species?
Pardon me?
Are these native species?
Yes, they are. Yep. We changed it because these are aesthetically much nicer looking than pine. Not that I dislike pines. A lot of these are flowering all year. We have tomorrow we have 50 roses coming in. We're doing some extensive landscaping. The pines just didn't seem, it was just something that we couldn't work with. So we thought this would be a better, we figured the board would approve this, we'd like it more.
How high did they grow? Compared to a pine?
The pines?
No, the pear trees.
Yeah, they'll go 25 to 30 feet.
The pear?
Yeah. 25 feet.
Yeah, more like 20, 25 feet.
Yeah, 20, 25 feet.
Because it's two stories. Because where they are, I think it was a 10 to 12 foot drop. So the elevation up here on the road is 272, and...
Well, they build this up, the berm actually goes up.
Yeah, where's the highest elevation?
I think here, so it's 272.5.
Okay.
So it's level with the road.
And then down here, it's 260. Really, that's only, it's saying it's only 4 feet difference?
How much?
Maybe.
4 feet.
If you look at the other plans.
I'm thinking it's deeper than that.
I'm thinking you're right.
Well, I would go with the engineer.
Okay.
So... Grading, so...
All right, let's go read this. Yep.
272.5.
Building's level 272? Wow. And the building's down here at 265?
266.
266, wow, I thought it was a lot more than that.
265.
Yeah. Well, you have, in maturity, you have a 25 foot tree. That's all I wanted to get is how high that tree is.
I think the pears are going to, if you plant white pines there in 10 years, you're not going to see the building. Because they get so bushy. So with the pear trees, you can continually see the building, and in the winter, they drop the leaves out.
Right.
Continue to see the storage building.
Yeah.
Right, which is a plus and minus, right?
Right.
I think, if I remember when Bob Priscilla was here, he was saying pines to provide screening.
Right.
There's only two buildings here.
But then you can't see...
Pardon me?
The business.
There's only two buildings here.
So...
The other three are featured.
That's right.
We'll just sell the rest of them.
So the question is, are we going to have to...
Well, I think just...
Let's make a motion to approve the swap.
Yeah.
Yeah, we could just...
Yeah.
Unless anybody has any...
Are they edible pears?
It's only for people who use the self-storage and who have a site.
Was there some reason that we went with white pine?
That was under the proposal problem. Yeah, the initial landscaper just came up with that, and it got approved. It was just, as you can see, the landscape drawing is very simple. It was eight white pines.
I think, you know, when you have the reason for the pines was the screening to hide a little bit of the storage area. You know what I mean? As they grow, because they don't drop the leaves and stuff like that. But then, I think Dave or Ryan, you might have mentioned, you start to lose the site that, you have the sign there that tells you self-storage, but when you're looking through,
you wouldn't be able to see properties, the backs are, the back buildings and stuff like that.
Yeah, I mean, white pine, that'll be open like that, we'll just.
Yeah.
It'd be massive.
If you're comfortable, if you're both comfortable with that, then I would just make a motion to amend the landscape in 1831 to include, what kind of pear?
Bradford. Bradford pear.
Bradford pear instead of white pine.
That's you.
Second. Oh, I make a motion to modify the landscaping plan at 1831.
Milltown.
Milltown Avenue to exchange the trees as presented.
Brad, a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Good to go.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okey dokey now. All right, new business, referral from town council regarding proposed, oh.
B.
I'm sorry, I crossed it out, okay. Bond release for 89-17 Anderson Road, Lindsay Estates.
So, yes, this does go back to 1989. This is.
I don't know if I was born.
This is a subdivision, one of these outstanding bonds that we've had for a long time. It had been reduced over time, but Kurt reviewed it, and I spoke with the woman today, which is amazing, because I actually had the phone number that was still valid in the file, and she picked up, and we talked, and she said, you know, this is my fault, I haven't been on top of this, and I said, you're not alone, there's a few of these hanging out there. But long story short, the subdivision obviously is complete, and the remaining, the outstanding issues were plantings around the interior lots. So Kurt said that, he said, the bond posted for the above listed subdivision was reduced in 2001 to $3,600 to cover some remaining tree plantings and installation of property corner pins. I looked at as-built drawings for each of the four lots created as part of the subdivision, and the drawings indicate that all of the property pins have been set. Based upon the attached aerial photo of the subdivision lots, there appears to be significant tree buffer plantings between the front and rear lots. Homes were built on these lots approximately 25 years ago. If the plan, if the PZC concurs, I would recommend that the remaining bond funds posted for the subdivision be released. So there were four lots again.
Where are we?
This is on the Wallingford Northford line. So this is Anderson.
No,
is it F?
Yep, that's my house.
Oh. So here, from it. So then here are the plantings that were required.
Yep.
And then here's a motion.
Subdivision.
It was a four lot subdivision.
Yeah, but that was like a thousand years ago. And I said, well, then maybe it's just called Anderson Lindsay Estates or something. I had no idea. Except those houses have been there, you know.
Since 1989?
Since I moved really to Connecticut.
I move to release the remaining bond for Lindsay Estates subdivision planning and zoning application 8917 Anderson Road, R40 zone. Owner applicant Marianne Coleman Bettini.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor? Aye.
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 I got a little nervous there. It passes 3-0. Okay.
Trees are 20 years old.
You can see me roll my lawn.
Referral from the town council.
Okay, so new business, item C, referral from town council regarding proposed assessment deferral program.
Yes, so I'm gonna pass this out to you and then I'll explain it. So with an 824 referral, this is from the town council, this is required by statute for programs like this, which is, this is an assessment deferral program that I've been working on with the town manager and the town assessor. So I'll just kind of go through this memo. Under the Connecticut General Statutes 1265D, a municipality can offer a an assessment deferral program. There's also the ability for a municipality to have just a deferred assessment without having to go through this lengthier program under 1265, I believe it's B or C, which we've done in the past. We did, I think, in the 90s for Firelight. This program, however, is, again, a lengthier process because the town council has to adopt a resolution, and then we have to develop an application, but it provides the town with a better benefit. So what this program does is, under 1265D, a municipality can designate a territory within its borders as a rehabilitation area. Again, in talking with the town manager and the town assessor, and then looking at what other municipalities have done, it's most beneficial to designate the entire town as a rehabilitation area and then set criteria. So you're not trying to guess as to where development may or may not occur. So what we've done is we've developed a draft resolution for the town council to review and an application which says that essentially any commercial development would be eligible for this. The biggest criteria though is that they have to have a 35% increase in their assessment through rehabilitation or construction that they do on the property.
So can you explain that a little more? So if it's assessed at $100, if they go in and rehab it, the assessment automatically goes up to?
If they go in and rehab it so that the result of their rehabilitation would result in a $135 assessment, then they would qualify for the program.
Gotcha.
And the program is a 5-year deferral. So I've bulleted here how it works. So the program again is open to all commercial businesses. The improvements need to result in the increased assessment of at least 35%. Projects have to have appropriate permits for zoning, wetlands, building, that's key. And then they complete this application. If they are approved by the town council, that's who would have the final vote, they can start their construction work. They cannot do any construction work prior to and be eligible for this program. They have to wait. Once a CO is issued, so the assessment would be fixed during that construction period. Once a CO is issued or 2 years after approval of the application, whichever is sooner, the assessment would be deferred for 5 years. So year one, they would just be paying whatever that locked-in assessment was before they started doing any work on it. Year two would be that base assessment plus 20%, year three plus 40%, on and on until year six, they're at 100%.
Which is the 35%.
Which includes that 35% increase.
Who does the assessment?
The town assessor.
Okay, so what the town assessor will do is go out to this, when there's an application, go out to a site, say, okay, here's the assessed value. I'm just gonna say it's $100.
Yep.
And so then somebody comes in, they pick up they purchase the property, whatever it might be, and then within 5 years, they're paying the 100, the original plus 35%.
Yes.
The assessment.
Yes.
Minimum 35.
And then the draft resolution that we are sharing with the town council says that it would take effect October 1st. That could be changed. We actually have, what spurred all of this is that the Capasso and Sons at 1011 Middletown, they're doing that large improvement, which you approved their site plan. They had asked about a assessment deferral program. So that's when we started looking into what we can do by state statute. So their timeline is a little bit longer. I think they're even maybe 6 months out from starting any construction. But there are a few other projects that I know of in town that could benefit from this if they were interested. So the October 1st may be on the later side, in my opinion. Maybe we want to have it be August if the town council were amenable to this whole thing. But the other thing is that there would be a sunset date so that every 5 years this would be reviewed and the town council would decide if it's worth it or not.
This is only for existing buildings? What about the, what's that, Dollar General going in? Is that, they belong to this?
No, it's only for
existing.
New, right, so if you cannot start construction until you've been approved.
Okay. But this would be for an existing site too, right?
Right, so it could be for...
Let's just say like the Northford set, the plaza up there. Say somebody wanted to go in, the current owner wanted to go and do something.
Yes.
They could fall under this and then do it, but when the assessor goes out, they're going to have to assess it for either 35 or more, 35% more.
Yes.
To be part of this program.
Yes. So like Capasso and Sons, that was an existing building. They wanted to renovate it.
Have they already started renovations though?
They have just taken down the front part, so.
So they've started work?
They haven't started rebuilding them.
But they started work. They get a permit to take the building down. Right?
I would say no. I mean, they've decreased their assessed value because they are missing a quarter of their building. They took it down, right? So their assessment would actually go down.
Got it. And so besides the capacity, what was the motivation behind this? I mean, as far as like, why put it over across the whole town?
Right. So in the resolution, we talk about, you know, it's to retain business and to have another... something in the town's toolbox to try and attract business, maybe not even attract businesses to town, but retain businesses for them to say, okay, if I add on to my existing building here, as opposed to moving to another town, I can actually defer my assessment for 5 years. So it's twofold, to improve the quality of the buildings in town, but also more to attract and retain businesses.
It also might make spark some improvements just from different, from some owners right now.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I mean, this would be something like, maybe the Mill Pond Tavern that's been dragging their feet. You know, this might be an incentive to move along. Or
right.
Yeah.
Right.
Because something like that, where it was like at one time through the transfer of ownership, they took out all the kitchen.
Yes.
Which was probably it added some value. Mm-hmm. So that doesn't exist there now. So you go in there, you get access, you put all that equipment back in, you might have might provide some of the opportunity. Also maybe something like some of the IGAs and stuff like that.
Right.
So some of the food, it's
right.
Possible.
What about converting the Sunoco gas station to a Sammy Mart? Is that gonna be a 35% improvement on converting it from a gas station to a mini mart?
Know.
Well, I have to go through the application process and do that.
In talking with the assessor, it has to be fairly substantial because there was another local business in town that's looking to purchase a building on Commerce Drive, and they have to possibly put in sprinklers, but that wouldn't count because that's required by building code. But making improvements like expanding the loading dock, that would count. But again, it's a question of getting it up to that 35%, which is why the town assessor,
that's a pretty high amount,
decided
yeah.
the threshold to be higher,
yeah.
because we wanted a significant investment.
Right, because if you're not, because then somebody takes to defer for the 5 years, or year six for the 5 years, and they decide to leave,
mm-hmm.
they put some money into expanding the business, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
This doesn't lock the assessment, though, for 5 years, though, does it?
No. You mean following?
Well,
the assessment.
No, like every
seven.
Year our taxes go up.
Well,
that's
mill rate. The assessment wouldn't change. The assessment wouldn't change during that period. If you bought, if it was being assessed at $100, for the, it's locked in for that $100, but the mill rate might change.
Right.
But the assessment value.
See, they only do assessments every 10 years anyway, right?
Right, so I mean, that's something you might wanna take, include in there about the, how many years?
There is something in here in the resolution, I didn't include all of the details, but it talks about a general, the effect of the general revaluation by the town. So, I'll just read this because I can't explain it very well though. So in the event of a general revaluation by the town in the year in which such rehabilitation or construction is completed, resulting in an increase in assessment, only that portion of the increase resulting from such rehab shall be deferred. Does that make sense? So if there's a reval and there's an increase, but they're part of this program, only the increase would be deferred. In the event of a general reval.
Only the increase would be, and that's, so it stays as it is.
Right, it would be locked in during that 5-year program. If there's an increase.
Which isn't really good, right?
Yeah. And then it says, in the event of a general revaluation in any year after the year in which such rehabilitation or construction is completed, such deferred assessment shall be increased or decreased in proportion to the increase or decrease in the total assessment.
But that's saying after the construction,
right?
Not after the 5 years. So the first one you read, I just, the first statement you just read, it sounded to me that you're deferring it for all those years, but in that one it says after construction.
Mm-hmm. It says if the reassessment is done during construction, only the new portion will be deferred, right?
In the year in which
you can smooth out the details. The general part of it.
It's a tax question.
Let all that. I mean, I think it's a great idea.
Again, the town council did an 824 referral to get your input on it. And then they're having a public hearing on June 7th at 7:30.
I make a motion that the Planning and Zoning Commission report favorably on the Town Council CGS section 8-24 referral regarding the property assessment deferral program.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? I just think it's a good idea. So, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Seeing none, that passes 3-0. Okie dokie. And now on to the town planner's report.
So we have received, I think I'd mentioned this a few meetings ago, an application for a laundry facility on Route 1. It's technically in the front of the buildings in Brantford. The rear of the building is in North Brantford, next to Bill Miller's Castle.
At the old antique building,
yes,
or whatever it was?
Yep. So I'm holding their application, and they know that, until we get a decision from Brantford, because if they don't have approval from Brantford, that's where they have access onto the road, so it just doesn't make sense for
us
to hear it.
Is city sewers there?
Yes, I believe so.
Okay.
Because Evergreen
Woods
has it, so.
So do you know what the hold up in Brantford is?
There were some neighbors who had concerns, and they have a different process. They have a special use permit required, so it's a public hearing, and they're going through a longer process.
Okay.
So I expect that on the June 2nd meeting.
All right.
Okay, then we talked last time about a text amendment to just make sure that our regulations conform with the state statute. So for nonconformities, under section 5.5, we had in here that restoration is started within a period of 1 year from such casualty and is diligently prosecuted to completion. I'm recommending that we delete all of that. And I spoke with the town attorney, Pat Young, and he concurred. Also under 5.6.4, discontinuance, no nonconforming use of buildings or structures which shall have been discontinued for a continuous period of 1 year shall thereafter be resumed or replaced. I recommend deleting that because there's case law that says that you can't set a time limit.
So that means you can go, so if it's a nonconforming, you can go back to nonconforming at any time.
Grandfather day.
Even if there's a change of use in between, you can go back.
That's where it gets, right. That's where case law really comes in. So if you think of, if my home is in an industrial area, but my home was built in 1954, our zoning came in 62, and in 65 it was zoned industrial. But it stopped being used as a residential, but then I go back after 5 years, I can still use it as residential even though it's zoned industrial, and we wouldn't allow residential in industrial. There's no time limit. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. No, it doesn't make sense at all. It's based upon intent of the home.
Yeah,
it was the home before it was industrial.
It's
But see, in the past, we've had something where if it was non-conforming and then it went to another use, you couldn't go back. That's how we have. Once you went out of whatever that non-conforming use was, and you did something else to it, you couldn't go backwards in time. That's the way this regulation was applied.
Right,
but now this is saying, like just Carrie said, you can, it could be used as residential and industrial zone. It can be used as an office for the industrial or whatever it might be, but then you go back and use it as a home again.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so.
But you know, say you demolish the home, that would be intent to abandon, I would say.
Yeah.
You know, you couldn't, I wouldn't think you could demolish a home, leave, come back 5 years later and say, no, I want to rebuild my
right.
home here. Because there was intent to abandon. So that's the other component of it.
Right.
I was thinking more of the gas station on Route 80 that they had pumps at a location that were grandfathered in, and then they took them out. Then I guess because they had them before, they can put them back in.
Well, it was never a change of use, though. It was always a serviced area.
They won't let them put it back in the same location.
It's not in the same place. They wouldn't let them put them in the same place, but they can put them back in.
Okay, let's go back a little farther. The Northford store. Those of us that are old remember there used to be gas station. There should be gas pumps in the front of the Northford store. Can they go back and put gas pumps back?
No, because I think in both of those situations, I would argue intent to abandon. You remove the pumps. You remove the tanks. So you would argue there was, doesn't matter
yeah.
how many years went by, you intended to remove them. If they left the pumps there and they just weren't working, they became obsolete, but then wanted to put in new technology, then.
But if you have a house in industrial zone that was a house and you moved out, that's intentional, and you made it industrial, but now you're saying you can go back to it.
Well, long as the house is still there.
As long as the house is still there,
like
right?
Like, say the industrial, you know, say there's industrial and there's that lot.
Yeah.
So the people that own the company or business say they're going to use it for office space for now. They leave the house there. They don't make any changes really to it. Maybe some, you know, whatever architectural slight changes. And then also they decide, you know what, we're going to move our office somewhere else. We have this house. It can be used as a house again.
Mm-hmm.
So they go back because they didn't abandon it. They didn't make major changes into it. So they go back and use the house. So I mean, as long as Pat's saying that, I mean, basically all we're doing is taking the timeline off of it because
right.
of case law in the
yes.
past.
But this
yes.
sounds like it's not even the same owner, though, right?
Well, it doesn't matter.
It could be somebody. It could be 30 years later, and you have a business that's non-conforming business, and it closes up and it's been empty.
Yeah.
And now someone wants to go back and open the same business in the same building, it's grandfathered in, because it was used as that type of business before.
Possibly. I mean, that's kind of getting into the detail. I think.
We would do so, if there was properties like that, and there's some change in usage, I mean, it would be up to the planning and zoning to change the use on that. So like if there was something similar to that piece of property that's industrial, I mean, we could probably maybe do some things like that to change it, to make it so somebody would go in there and maybe knock the house down and make industrial out of it.
There was a proposal for a business up in Northford. There was a house that could turn into a business and was empty, and the guy wanted to open a landscaping business in there or some kind of business.
I'm forgetting.
It was in the Northford end of town. There was an old red house or something.
Oh, no. You think, is that the people that had the lawsuit? No.
So Tuckett Road?
No.
The guy came in and wanted to open a business in there, and he was going to do like mulch and stuff. And
Right. Right, so that's a good example. Because
it was a non-conforming business.
Right, a non-conforming business in a residential zone. Right, that's near the Durham line.
Yeah.
He's open.
Yes. Okay. Right, so it doesn't matter how much time went by.
Yeah, but he opened, because that was a store, right? Isn't it? Wasn't that
It's zoned residential.
It is, mm-hmm. Okay.
But it was a non-conforming business.
It was a convenience store at one time.
And it was a pizza place, and it was...
So basically, all we're doing is reducing the timeline. And if you know, under Pat's recommendation, if that's case law through Connecticut, I think it would be in our best interest to...
How does this cover non-conforming junkyards?
What's the question?
Well, it was a non-conforming junkyard, and someone wants to open a junkyard back up again.
I don't know. I'd have to think about the whole, look at the whole case.
It's not a structure. It's just a...
It's a use.
It's just a use of the property. It wasn't...
I guess you would have to prove that it existed prior to zoning, and then... after zoning.
Wouldn't they have to comply with current regulations? I mean, because they were grandfathered in, they just can't.
Right, that's a tricky one, because junkyards are prohibited, I believe.
This is the one up by the old...
If you had a junkyard, your house in manicured ground, I consider that abandonment.
Right. Well, that's what you have.
Yeah. I mean, I consider that abandonment. That you just can't necessarily go back. If somebody goes in there, cleans up the junkyard, makes a real nice house out of it, plants trees, and it's got a nice yard going, and they also add in the guy who, or somebody, you know, says, "Oh, I'm going to make it back to the junkyard," would they abandon that nonconformity? If you don't abandon it, you can. This is all that regulation now says, is that if you don't abandon it, you can come back and do it. But once you abandon it, then you can't come back to it.
That's what you're
right.
Saying.
So I mean, no, that's what the regulation is. You can go back as long as it's not abandoned. Like if you have that house, you know, if somebody uses that house as an office, it's industrial, and then they don't want to use it anymore, they can still use the house. They didn't really abandon it. It was still used as a house.
Well, that business in Northford then would be the exact same thing. It was a house turned into a legal business, non-conforming. It was closed. It was no longer an active business in any way, and he went in and reopened the business in there.
No, but I don't think it was ever fully occupied as a home. There was residential residences on the second floor. And
it's
intent to abandon is difficult to prove.
Right. So that's the only question.
Well, I mean, if you put it in a junkyard, you could tell. If somebody cleans it all up, they definitely abandoned it.
But we were saying it could be a separate party that went back and wanted to reuse.
I don't know. It could be a separate party. You'd have to look at that.
How about licensing? If you, using the junkyard as an example, if you lost your license to operate.
Permit or something, right?
Yeah. Then
it's abandonment. Yeah.
Well, there's when you get into the case law, it's amazing what you can argue.
Well, that's why.
Right.
Tell Pat to sharpen his pencil up,
right,
just in case.
Right.
We'll send Dave and Ron in there. What do they call them?
You guys can do a mock trial with them.
Wait a minute, you know, Indians used to.
Oh, wait, we're going way.
On my property, so I can open a barbecue.
There you go. But I mean, these changes.
So I've filled out an application form as planning and zoning being the applicant.
Yep.
I'm showing this to you to make sure that you're okay with this, and that we would, this would be the application that's being submitted or seen now, and then we would open the public hearing on June 16th.
Perfect. Any other items?
Yes.
Adjourned.
Was that really that obvious? Karen.
Just a drill sergeant today.
We get a revised agenda, and all Carrie's stuff is missing.
Other items. There could be a lot of things under other items. Okay, so this, I'll just keep this brief. There are just two things. So I haven't been here during many subdivisions, but over time, one thing that I've noticed in looking at the list of street names throughout town, there's a lot of similar names in town. So there's a Dogwood Lane, Dogwood Road, Brook Lane, Brook Road, Evergreen Drive, Evergreen Road.
And when in right around graduation time, there's a fundraiser for the girls' soccer team.
Mm-hmm.
We put balloons on the mailboxes.
Oh.
And being that I've done it for 7 years, people will say Dogwood on there, and there's a, you know, a couple of those. There's a bunch of them.
Right.
Yeah,
well,
so.
And it's not too bad if it's, you know, like Arthur, what is it?
Court and Arthur.
Lane. Arthur Court and Arthur Road are right next to each other.
Yeah.
Or Auger Road Extension. But when you're talking about Dogwood,
yeah.
So Dogwood Lane is here, and Dogwood Road is here. Or Evergreen Road, Evergreen Drive, Oak Drive, Oak Hill Drive. So my question for the commission is, have you changed, looking at the statute, planning and zoning is the authority that could change the name of the road. The reason being is that it's also a public safety issue. Because with dispatch, just the potential for misinterpretation. I wanted to just raise this as just a point of discussion at this point. I think it would be planning and zoning and the town council. And it would have an impact on the residents, because there could be 40 homes, you know, on some of these streets, and changing all of your documentation, your deed, everything.
Going forward, you could do, I would go back and change existing roads. Any new roads that get put in should be reviewed for stuff. Well, you get emergency calls now. I mean, they probably get GPS tracking now saying where.
Not
it
if
is.
It's a cell phone.
Cell phone should even be more.
No, because you can block it.
Yeah.
You can turn on.
I think with a landline it does come up, but
yes.
So I want to just raise this as food for thought at this point.
I mean, if there was, I mean,
there's
just
no
besides just besides the D part of it, but. Anytime you've ever had to change something, you have to go through your whole life and change it, because everything you have, from bills to internet and everything out there, I mean, there would have to be, I mean, personally for me to consider something like that, there would have to be a major public safety issue. I mean, I agree with Ron, Dave said that, you know, going forward, but, it would make it easier to deliver balloons if they weren't named the same, but I will.
Right. Yeah. I mean, we're clearly not doing this for the pizza guy. You know, it's a public safety. You know, that's the bigger.
But
question.
I would definitely. I think any subdivisions going forward, we should make. You know, we should. Whoever's doing subdivisions should provide us the name of potential names of the road, so we can take a look at it and
we'll
make sure to know.
Who makes up the name? Well, typically it's developers who propose it, but
no,
it's
no,
planning and zoning.
I'm saying going
yeah.
forward, you want to rename, let's say, my street. And
I was going to name it after you.
That's what I'm thinking.
Yeah, yeah.
It should be named after me.
You're bringing the oak from one side of the town to the other side of town, and the strongest oak wins.
Okay, so
I mean,
no,
that should
just,
be definitely
I
be
wanted
considered.
To just get
yeah. that
you know,
definitely
your initial
be,
reaction.
But that should be considered with any subdivisions coming up.
Okay.
Because I know when I moved into town in '85, they were going around doing something for emergencies. They actually had changed my name, my street name, because it was Notch Hill, but the mailbox and driveway were on Ledgewood. So they officially changed the address to Ledgewood. The only bill I got that said Notch Hill was UI for some reason, because the power came off of Notch Hill. Everything else came off of Ledgewood.
Well, and I guess the town did go through this process with Countryside Circle, I think, because there was a Countryside or a Circle Drive.
Circle Drive.
There were two Circle Drives, and then they added Countryside Circle.
They had two Circle Drives.
I think going way back, so. We'll see. I'll bring this back if it continues.
Yeah. Plus, there's always the zip codes. If it's over, it seems like one's in Northford and one's in North Branford, so they have a different zip code.
Right. For mailings, right.
Yeah.
Right. Okay, so the last announcement that I have is that the North Branford Land Conservation Trust has invited everyone to their annual meeting on Thursday, June 2nd. Unfortunately, it's the same night as our meeting, but it starts at 6. And they're having Joe and Ida DeFrancisco. They recently were the recipients of a 2016 Outstanding Young Farmers Award, which was a national award. So they were Joe DeFrancisco was one of four farmers to receive this, which is great. So
where is that going to be?
Young Farmers?
It is going to be, good question.
Hasn't DeFrancisco
at Stanley T. Williams
for generations?
June 2nd, 6 p.m.
How big can the Young Farmers now?
Is it a son?
Yes.
No, that's
no, it's his son.
I would assume it's his son.
Well, he's 50, been 50s, right?
No. He has three sons.
At least. I mean,
Who got awarded now? Because it was the girl that was the blonde. They're in her 50s. They seem to chatter about it.
No, but it's his son who received the award. There was a YouTube thing on
the. So they got the award too, guys. They showed them in the picture.
Oh, okay. Yep.
I think it was in the Sound, maybe? Last week?
Oh, could be.
I think so.
Yep.
Don't say it was the same.
Anything else?
That's it.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Oh, you got beat.
Yes, I did. Yeah.